Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Die by the Gun by William W. Johnstone with J.A. Johnstone. Narrated by Danny Campbell. Chapter 1. Dewey McKenzie spun away from the bar, the finger of whiskey in his shot glass sloshing as he avoided a body flying through the air. He winced as a gun discharged not 5 feet away from his head. He hastily knocked back what remained of his drink, tossed the glass over his shoulder to land with a clatter on the bar, and reached for the Smith & Wesson Model 3 he carried thrust into his belt. A heavy hand gripped his shoulder with painful intensity. The bartender rasped, "Don't go pulling that smoke wagon, boy. You do, and things will get rough." Mac tried to shrug off the apron's grip and couldn't. Powerful fingers crushed into his shoulder so hard that his right arm began to go numb. He looked across the barroom and wondered why the hell he had ever come to Fort Worth, much less venturing into Hell's Half Acre, where anything, no matter how immoral or unhealthy, could be bought for 2 bits or a lying promise. 2 different fights were going on in this saloon, and they threatened to involve more than just the drunken cowboys swapping wild blows. The man with the 6-gun in his hand continued to ventilate the ceiling with 1 bullet after another. Blood spattered Mac's boots as one of the fistfights came tumbling in his direction. He lifted his left foot to keep it from getting stomped on by the brawlers. A steer had already done that a month earlier, when he had been Chuckwagon cook on a cattle drive from Waco up to Abilene. He had taken his revenge on the annoying mountain of meat, singling it out for a week of meals for the Rolling J crew. Not only had the steer been clumsy where it stepped, it had been tough. More than one cowboy had complained. Try as he might to tenderize the steaks by beating, by marinating, by cursing, Mac had failed. That hadn't been the only steer he had come to curse. The entire drive had been fraught with danger, and more than one of the crew had died. "That's why," he said out loud. "What's that?" The barkeep eased his grip and let Mac turn from the fight. "After the drive, after the cattle got sold off and sent on their way to Chicago from the Abilene Railroad yards, I decided to come back to Texas to pay tribute to a friend who died." The bartender's expression said it all. He was in no mood to hear maudlin stories any more than he was to break up the fights or prevent a disgruntled cowboy from plugging a gambler he thought was cheating him at stud poker. "Then you need another drink in his memory." When Mac didn't argue the point, the barkeep poured an inch of rye in a new glass and made the 2-bit coin Mac put down vanish. A nickel and change rolled across the bar. "This is for you, Flag. I just hope it's not too hot wherever you are." Mac lifted the glass and looked past it to the dirty mirror behind the bar. A medium-sized hombre with longish dark hair and a deeply tanned face gazed back at him. The man, he saw reflected, wasn't the boy who had been hired as a cook by a crusty old trail boss. He had Patrick Flagg to thank for making him grow up. A quick toss emptied the glass. The fiery liquor burned a path to his belly and kindled a blaze there. He belched and knew he had reached his limit. Mac had no idea why he had come to this particular gin mill, other than he was footloose and drifting after being paid off for the trail drive. The money burned a hole in his pocket, but Dewey McKenzie never had been much of a spendthrift. Growing up on a farm in Missouri hadn't given him the chance to have 2 nickels to rub together, much less important money to waste. With deft instinct, he stepped to the side as 2 brawling men crashed into the bar beside him, lost their footing, and sprawled on the sawdust-littered floor. Mac looked down at them, then let out a growl. He reached out and grabbed the man on top by the back of his coat. A hard heave lifted the fighter into the air until the fabric began to tear. Mac swung the man around, deposited him on his feet, and looked him squarely in the eye. What mess have you gotten yourself into now, Rattler? Hey, as I live and breathe, the cowboy exclaimed. Howdy, Mac. Never thought our paths would cross again after Abilene. Rattler ducked as his opponent surged to his feet and launched a wild swing. Mac leaned to one side, the bony fist passing harmlessly past his head. He batted the arm down to the bar and pounced on it, pinning the man. Whatever quarrel you've got with my friend, consider it settled, Mac told the man sternly. Ain't got a quarrel. I got a bone to pick. The drunk wrenched free, reared back, and lost his balance, sitting hard amid the sawdust and vomit on the barroom floor. Come on, Rattler. Let's find somewhere else to do some drinking. Mac grabbed the front of the wiry man's vest and pulled him along into the street. Mayhem filled Hell's Half Acre tonight. In either direction along Calhoun Street, saloons belched customers out to continue the battles that had begun inside. Others, done with their recreation outside, crowded to get back in for more liquor. Mac brushed dirt off his threadbare clothes. Spending some of his pay on a new coat made sense. He whipped off his black, broad-brimmed hat and smacked it a couple of times against his leg. Dust clouds rose. His hair had been plastered back by sweat. The lack of any wind down the Fort Worth street kept it glued down as if he had used bear grease. He wiped tears from his cat-green eyes and knew he had to get away from the dust and filth of the city. It was dangerous on the trail, tending a herd of cattle, but it was cleaner and wide-open prairie. He might get stomped on by a steer, but never had to worry about being shot in the back. He knew better than to ask Rattler what the fight had been over. Likely it had started for no reason other than to blow off steam. I thought you were going to find a gunsmith and get some work there, Mac said to his companion. You're a better tinkerer than most of them in this town. Mac touched the Model 3 in his belt. Rattler had worked on it from Waco to Abilene during the drive, and had turned his pappy's old sidearm into a deadly weapon that shot straight and true every time the trigger was pulled. For that, Mac thanked Rattler. For teaching him how to draw fast and aim straight, he gave another silent nod to Patrick Flagg. More than teaching him how to draw faster than just about anyone, Flagg had also taught him when not to draw at all. Rattler said, And I thought you was heading back to New Orleans to woo that filly of yours. What was her name? Evie? Evangeline, Mac said. Yeah, you went on and on, even calling out her name in your sleep. With enough money, you should have been able to win her over. Mac knew better. He loved Evangeline Holdstock, and she had loved him until Pierre Leclerc had set his cap for her. Leclerc's plans included taking over Evie's father's bank after marrying her, probably inheriting it when he murdered Micah Holdstock. Being framed for Micah's murder had been enough to convince Mac to leave New Orleans. Worse, the frame had also convinced Evie to have nothing to do with him other than to scratch out his eyes if he got close enough to the only woman he had ever loved. His only hope of ever winning her back was to prove Leclerc had murdered Holdstock. Somehow his determination to do that had faded after Leclerc had sent killers after him to Waco. Mac smiled ruefully. If he hadn't been dodging them, he never would have signed on with the Rolling J crew and found he had a knack for cooking and cattle herding. The smile melted away when he realized Evie was lost forever to him, and returning to New Orleans meant his death, either from Leclerc's killers or at the end of a hangman's rope. "There's other fish in the sea. That's what they say," Rattler went on, slurring his morsel of advice. He braced himself against a hitching post to point at a 3-story hotel across the street. "The House of Love, they call it. They got gals for every man's taste there, or so I've been told. Let's go find ourselves fillies and spend the night, Mac. We owe it to ourselves after all we've been through." That's a mighty attractive idea, Rattler, but I want to dip my beak in some more whiskey. You can go and dip your, other beak. Don't let me hold you back. They got plenty of ladies there, soiled doves, Rattler laughed. They got plenty of them to last the live long night, but I worry this town's gonna run out of popskull. With an expansive sweep of his arm, he indicated the dozen saloons within sight along Calhoun Street. It was past midnight, and the drinking was beginning in earnest now. Every cowboy in Texas seemed to have crowded in with a powerful thirst, demanding to be slaked by gallons of bad liquor and bitter beer. Which watering hole appeals to you, Rattler? Max saw each had a different attraction. Some dance halls had half-naked women willing to share a dance, rubbing up close for a dime or until the piano player keeled over, too drunk to keep going. Others featured exotic animals or claimed imported food and booze from the four corners of the world. Mac had become cynical enough to believe the whiskey and brandy they served came from the bottles filled like all the others, from kegs and tanks brought into Hell's Half-Anchor just after sunrise. That's when most customers were passed out or too blind drunk to know the fancy French cognac they paid $10 a glass for was no different from the 10-cent tumbler filled with the same liquor at the drinking emporium next door. It was referred to as poor man's whiskey.
Don't much matter. That one's close enough so I don't stagger too much getting to it.
The man put his arm around Mac's shoulders for support, turned on unsteady feet, and took a step. He stopped short and looked up at a tall, dark man dressed in black.
"Excuse us, mister, we got some mighty hard drinking to do, and you're blocking the way." "Dewey McKenzie," the man said in a hoarse whisper, almost drowned out by raucous music pouring from inside the saloon.
"Yeah, he's my friend," Rattler said, pulling away from Mac and stumbling to the side. When he did so, he got in the way of the dark man's shot. Mac had never seen a man move faster. The peacemaker cleared leather so swiftly the move was a blur. Fanning the hammer sent three slugs ripping out in a deadly rain that tore into Rattler's body. He threw up his arms, a look of surprise on his face, as he collapsed backward into Mac's arms. He died without saying another word.
"Damn it," the gunman growled, stepping to the side to get a better shot at Mac.
Shock disappeared as Mac realized he had to move or die. With a heave, he lifted his dead friend up and tossed him into the shooter. The corpse knocked the gunman's aim off, so his fourth bullet tore past Mac and sailed down Calhoun Street. Almost as an afterthought, someone farther away let out a yelp when the bullet found an unexpected target. Mac had practiced for hours during the long cattle drive. His hand grabbed the wooden handles on the S&W. The pistol pulled free of his belt. He wasn't even aware of all he did, drawing back the hammer as he aimed, the pressure of the trigger against his finger, the recoil as the revolver barked out its single deadly reply. The gunman caught the bullet smack in the middle of his chest. It staggered him. Propped against a hitching post, he looked down at a tiny red spot spreading on his gray-striped vest. His eyes came up and locked with Max.
"You shot me," he gasped.
He used both hands to raise his six-gun. The barrel wobbled back and forth.
"Why'd you kill Rattler?"
Mac held his gun in a curiously steady hand. The sights were lined on the gunman's heart. He never got an answer. The man's pistol blasted another round, but this one tore into the ground between them. He let out a tiny gurgling sound and toppled straight forward, like an army private at attention all the way down. A single twitch once he hit the ground was the only evidence of life fleeing.
"That's him!" a man shouted. "That's McKenzie! He gunned down Jimmy!"
Another man said,
"Well, he's not going to take kindly to this."
Mac looked up to see a pair of men pushing hurriedly through the saloon's batwing doors. It didn't take a genius to recognize the dead gunman's family. They might have been chiseled out of the same stone, broad shoulders, square heads, height within an inch of each other. Their coats were of the same fabric and color, and the peacemakers slung at their hips might have been bought on the same day from the same gunsmith. Even as they took in how the dead man had found the quarry Leclerc had put a bounty on, their hands went for their guns. Neither man was too quick on the draw, taking time to push away the long tails of their coats. This gave Mac the chance to swing his own gun around and get off a couple of shots. Flying lead whined past both men and into the saloon they had just exited. Glass broke inside and men shouted angrily. Then all hell broke loose as the patrons became justifiably angry at being targeted. Several of them boiled out of the saloon with guns flashing and fists flying. The two gunmen dodged Mac's slugs, but the rush of men from inside bowled them over, sending them stumbling out into the dusty street. Mac considered trying to dispatch them, then knew he had a tidal wave to hold back with only a couple of rounds. "Sorry, Rattler," he said, taking a second to touch the brim of his hat in tribute to his trail companion. They had never been friends, but they had been friendly. That counted for something during a cattle drive. He vaulted over Rattler's body, grabbed for the reins of a black stallion tethered to the side of the saloon, and jumped hard, landing in the saddle with a thud. The spirited animal tried to buck him off. Mac had learned how to handle even the proudest cayuse in any remuda. He bent low, grabbed the horse around the neck, and hung on for dear life as the horse bolted into the street. A new threat posed itself then, or one that had been delayed anyway. Both of the dead gunman's partners, or brothers, or whatever they were, opened fire on him. Mac stayed low, using the horse as a shield. "Horse thief!" The strident cry came from one of the gunmen. This brought out cowboys from a half dozen more saloons. Getting beaten to a bloody pulp or even shot full of holes meant nothing to these men, but having a horse thief among them was a hanging offense. "There he is!" Mac yelled as he sat up in the saddle and pointed down the street. "The thieving bastard just rounded the corner! After him!" The misdirection worked long enough for him to send a mob off on a wild goose chase, but that still left two men intent on avenging their partner. Mac put his head down again, jerked the horse's reins, and let the horse gallop into a barroom, scattering the customers inside. He looked around as he tried to control the horse in the middle of the sudden chaos he had created. Going back the way he came wouldn't be too smart. A quick glance in the mirror behind the bar showed both of the black-clad men crowding through the bat wings and waving their guns around. A savage roar caught his attention. In a corner crouched a black panther, snarling to reveal fierce fangs capable of ripping a man apart. No wonder the black stallion was going loco. He had to be able to smell the big cat. The huge creature strained at a chain designed to hold a riverboat anchor. The clamor rose as the bartender shouted at Mac to get his horse out of the saloon. The apron-clad man reached under the bar and pulled out a sawed-off shotgun. "Out, damn your eyes!" the bartender bellowed as he leveled the weapon. Mac whirled around and began firing, not at the panther, but at the wall holding the chain. The chain itself was too strong for a couple of bullets to break. The wood splintered as Mac's revolver came up empty. When the panther lunged again, it pulled the chain staple free and dragged it into the room. The customer nearest the cat screeched as heavy claws raked at him. Then the bartender fired his shotgun, and Mac yelped as rock salt burned his face and arm. Worse, the rock salt spooked the horse even more than the attacking panther. The stallion exploded like a 4th of July rocket. Mac did all he could to hang on as the horse leaped through a plate glass window. Glittering shards flew in all directions, but he was out of the saloon and once more in the street. The sense of triumph faded fast when both gunmen who'd been pursuing him boiled out through the window he had just destroyed. "That's him, Willie! That's the one that killed Jimmy!" Mac looked back at Death stalking him. A tall, broad man with a square head and the same dark coat pushed back the tails to reveal a double gun rig. Peacemakers holstered at either hip quickly jumped into the man's grip. Using both hands, the man started firing. And he was a damned good shot. Chapter 2. Dewey McKenzie jerked to the side and almost fell from the horse as a bullet tore a chunk from the brim of his hat. He glanced up and got a quick look at the moon through the hole. The bullet sailing around him motivated him to put his heels to the horse's flanks. Again, the horse bolted through the open door of a saloon. This one's crowd stared at a half-naked woman on stage gyrating to bad piano music. They were too preoccupied to be aware of the havoc being unleashed outside. Even a man riding through the back of the crowd hardly pulled their attention away from the lurid display. Mac slid from the saddle and tugged on the reins to get the horse out of the saloon. He had to shoulder men aside, which drew a few curses and surly looks, but people tended to get out of the way of a horse. Finally, he worked his way through the press of men who smelled of sweat and lust and beer. He emerged into the alley behind the gin mill. Walking slowly, forcing himself to regain his composure, he left the Tivoli Saloon behind and went south on Throckmorton Street. The city's layout was something of a mystery to him, but he remembered the wagon yard was between Main and Rusk, only a few streets over. He resisted the urge to mount and ride out of town. If he did that, the gang of cutthroats would be after him before dawn. His best chance of getting away was to fade into the woodwork and let the furor die down. Shooting his way out of Fort Worth was as unlikely to be successful as was galloping off. Where would he go? He had a few dollars left in his pocket from his trail drive pay, but he knew no one, had no friends, no place to go to ground for a week or two. Mac decided being footloose was a benefit. Wherever he went would be fine, with the gunmen unable to track him because he sought friends' help. He had no friends in Fort Worth. "Not going to get anybody else killed," he said bitterly. Sorry for Rattler catching the lead intended for him. He tugged on the stallion's reins and worked his way farther south along Rusk until he reached the wagon yard. He patted the horse's neck. It was a strong animal, one he would have loved to ride. But it was distinctive enough to draw attention he didn't need. "Come on, partner," Mac told the stallion quietly. The horse neighed, tried to nuzzle him, and then trotted along into the wagon yard. A distant corral filled with a dozen horses began to come awake. By the time he reached the office, the hostler was pulling up his suspenders and rubbing sleep from his eyes. He was a scarecrow of a man with a bald head and a prominent Adam's apple. "You're up early, mister," the man said. "Been on the trail? Need a place to stable your horse while you're whooping it up?" "I'm real down on my luck, sir," Mac said sincerely. "What would you give me for the horse?" "This one?" The livery man came over and began examining the horse. He rested his hand on the saddle and looked hard at Mac. "The tack, too?" "Why not? I need some money. But I also need another horse and gear. Swap this one for a less spirited horse, maybe, and a simple saddle?" "This is mighty fine workmanship." The man ran his fingers over the curlicues cut into the saddle. "Looks to be fine Mexican leatherwork. That goes for top dollar in these parts." "The horse, too. That's the best horse I ever did ride, but I got expenses." Mac let the sentence trail off. The livery man would come to his own conclusions. Whatever they might be would throw the gunmen off Mac's trail, if they bothered to even come to the wagon yard. He reckoned they would figure out which was his horse staked out back of the first saloon he had entered and wait for him to return for both the horse and his gear. Losing the few belongings he had, rankled like a burr under his saddle, but he had tangled before with bounty hunters Pierre Leclerc had set on his trail. The man didn't hire stupid killers. Mac's best, his only way to keep breathing was to leave Fort Worth fast and cut all ties with both people and belongings. A deep sigh escaped his lips. Rattler was likely the only one he knew in town. That hurt, seeing the man cut down the way he had been. But somehow, leaving behind his mare, saddle, and the rest of his tack tormented him even more.
"I know a gent who'd be willing to pay top dollar for such a fine horse, but you gotta sell the saddle, too. It's mighty fine. The work that went into it shows a master leathersmith at his peak. Yes, sir."
The liveryman cocked his head to one side and studied Mac as if he were a bug crawling up the wall. "Give me a few bucks, another horse and a saddle, and I'll be on my way."
"Can't rightly do that till I see if I can sell the stallion. I'm running a bit shy on cash. You wait here. Let me take the horse and see if the price is right. I might get you as much as $100.
"That much?" Mac felt his hackles rise. "That and another horse in tack?"
"Don't see horses this spirited come along too often. And that saddle?"
The man shook his head.
"Once in a lifetime."
"Do tell. So what's to keep you from taking the horse and riding away?"
"I own the yard. I got a reputation to uphold for honesty. Ask around. You go find yourself some breakfast. Might be I can get you as much as $150.
"And that's after you take your cut?"
"Right after," the man assured him.
Mac knew he lied through his teeth. "Is there a good restaurant around here? Not that it matters, since I don't have money for even a fried egg and a cup of water." He waited to see what the man offered. The response assured him he was right.
"Here, take $5, and advance against what I'll make selling the horse. That means I'll take it out of your share."
"Thanks," Mac said, taking the 5 crumpled greenbacks. He stuffed them into his vest pocket. "How long do you think you'll be?"
"Not long, not more than a half hour. That'll give you plenty of time to chow down and drink a second cup of coffee. Maggie over at the Bendix house boils up a right fine cup."
"Bendix house? That's over there?"
"Much obliged."
Mac touched the brim of his hat, making sure not to show the hole shot through and through. He let the man lead the horse away, then started for the restaurant. Only when the liveryman was out of sight did Mac spin around and run back to the yard. A quick vault over the fence took him to the barn. Rooting around, he found a serviceable saddle, threadbare blanket, bridle, and saddlebags. He pressed his hand against them. Empty. Right now, he didn't have time to search for food or anything more to put in them. He needed a slicker and a change of clothing. Most of all, he needed to leave. Now. Picking a decent-looking mare from the corral took only a few seconds. The one who trotted over to him was the one he stole. Less than a minute later, saddle and bridle hastily put on, he rode out. As he came out on Rusk Street, he caught sight of a small posse galloping in his direction. He couldn't make out the riders' faces, but they all wore black coats that might as well have been a uniform. Putting his heels to his horse's flanks, he galloped away, cut behind the wagon yard's buildings, and then faced a dilemma. Going south took him past the railroad and out onto the prairie. The flat, barren prairie where he could be seen riding for miles. Mac rode back past Houston Street and immediately dismounted, leading his horse to the side of the Comique Saloon. He had to vanish, and losing himself among the late night, or early morning now, imbibers was the best way to do it. The wagon yard owner would be hard-pressed to identify which horse was missing from a corral with a couple dozen animals in it. Mac cursed himself for not leaving the gate open so all the horses escaped. "Confusion to my enemies," he muttered. 2 quick turns of the bridle through an iron ring secured his mount. He circled the building, and started to go into the saloon. "Door's locked," came the warning from a man sitting in a chair on the far side of the door. He had his hat pulled down to shield his eyes from the rising sun, and the chair tilted back on its hind legs. "Do tell." Mac nervously looked around, expecting to see the posse on his trail closing in. He took the chair next to the man, duplicated his pose, and pulled his hat down, more to hide his face than to keep the sunlight from blinding him. "When do they open?"
"John Lear's got quite a place here, but he don't keep real hours. It's open when it's needed most. Otherwise, he closes up."
"Catches some shut-eye," the man laughed.
"Hardly. He's got a half dozen floozies in as many body houses, or so the rumor goes. Servicing all of them takes up his spare time."
"You figuring on waiting long for him to get back?"
The man pushed his hat back and looked over at Mac. He spat on the boardwalk, repositioned himself precariously in the chair, and crossed his arms over his chest before answering.
"Depends. I'm hunting for cowboys. The boss man sends me out to recruit for a drive. I come here to find who's drunkest. They're usually the most likely to agree to the lousy wages and a trip long enough to guarantee saddle sores on your butt.
You might come here and make such an appealing pitch, but I suspect you offer top dollar."
Mac tensed when a rider galloped past. The man wore a plaid shirt and jeans. He relaxed, not a bounty hunter.
"You're the type I'm looking for. Real smart fella you are. My trail boss wouldn't want a drunk working for him, and the boss man was a teetotaler. His wife's one of them temperance women. More than that, she's one of them suffragettes, they call 'em. Can't say I cotton much to going without a snort now and then, and giving women the vote like up in Wyoming's just wrong, but out on the trail nobody drinks. The cook keeps the whiskey, for medicinal purposes only."
"You been on a drive?"
"Along the Shawnee Trail." Mac's mind raced. Losing himself among a new crew driving cattle would solve most of his problems.
"That's not the way the Circle Arrow herd's headed. We're pushing west along the Goodnight-Loving Trail."
"Don't know it," Mac admitted.
"Don't matter. Mr. Flowers has been along it enough times that he can ride it blindfolded."
"Flowers?"
"Hiram Flowers, the best damn trail boss in Texas, or so I'm told, since I've only worked for a half dozen in my day."
The man rocked forward and thrust out his hand.
"My name's Cletus Grant. I do the chores Mr. Flowers don't like."
"Finding trail hands is one of them?" Mac asked as he clasped the man's hand.
"He doesn't stray far from the Circle Arrow."
"What's that mean?"
Mac shifted so his hand rested on his gun when another rider came down the street. He went cold inside when he remembered he hadn't reloaded. Truth to tell, all his spare ammunition was in his saddlebags, on his horse, left somewhere behind another saloon in Hell's Half Acre. When the rider rode on after seeing the comique was shuttered, Mac tried to mask his move by shifting in the chair. He almost toppled over. He covered by asking,
"You said the Circle Arrow owner was a teetotaler? He fall off the wagon?"
"His missus would never allow that, no sir. He upped and died 6 months back, in spite of his missus telling him not to catch that fever. Old Zeke Sullivan should have listened that time. About the only time he didn't do as she told him."
Cletus spat again, wiped his mouth, and asked, "You looking for a job?"
"I'm a piss-poor cowboy, but there's no better chuckwagon cook in all of Texas, or so I'm told, since I've only worked for the Rolling J in my day."
Cletus Grant's expression turned blank for a moment. Then he laughed.
"You got a sharp wit about you, son. I don't know that Mr. Flowers is looking for a cook, but he does need trail hands. Why don't me and you mosey on out to the Circle Arrow
and palaver a mite about the chance you'd ride with us to Santa Fe. That where the herd's destined? Might be all the way to Denver. Depends on what the market's like over in New Mexico territory. That's fair enough. I might be willing to go all the way to Denver, since I've never been there, but heard good things about the town. Cletus spat and shook his head sadly. Too damn many miners there looking to get rich by pulling skull-sized gold nuggets out of the hills. The real money comes in selling them picks, shovels, and beeves. Which is what the Circle Arrow intends, Max said. That suits me. He thrust out his hand for another shake to seal the deal, but Cletus held back this time. I can't hire you. Mr. Flowers is the one who has to do that. The man looked up and down the street, then rocked forward so all four legs hit the boardwalk. One was an inch shy of keeping the chair level. When Cletus stood, his limp matched the uneven chair. He leaned heavily on his right leg. Let's get on out to the ranch so he can talk with you. I don't see much in the way of promising recruits. Mac mounted and trotted alongside Cletus. The man's horse was a fine-looking gelding, well-kept and eager to run. From the way the horse under him responded, Mac thought it would die within a mile trying to keep pace. Yep, Cletus said, noticing Mac's interest. The Circle Arrow has the best damned horses. Mr. Flowers says it pays off in the long run, having the best. We don't lose as many cattle or drovers. That's good counsel. There are too many ways of dying on the trail without worrying about your horse dying under you. Mac thought a moment, then asked, What's the trail like? The Goodnight-Loving? The parts that don't kill you will make you wish you were dead. Drought and desert, Injuns and horse thieves, disease and despair. But the pay's good, Mac said, knowing the man tested him. And if I'm cooking, the food will be even better. You got a wit about you, son. Let's hope it's not just half a one. Cletus picked up the gate, forcing Mac to bring his horse to a canter. As he did so, he looked behind and saw two of the black-coated riders slowly making their way down the street. One pointed in Mac's direction, but the other shook his head and sent them down a cross street. Being with Cletus Grant might just have saved him. The bounty hunters thought he was alone. That had to be the answer to them not coming to question them about one of their gang getting shot down. The thought made Mac touch his S and W again. Empty. He kept reminding himself of that. The saddle sheath lacked a rifle, too. If they caught up and a fight ensued, and he couldn't bite them, he was out of luck. You got a curious grin on your face, Cletus said. What's so funny? Drought and desert, Indians and... I get the drift. And I wasn't joking about them. The trail's decent enough, but the dangers are real. Nothing like I'm leaving behind, Mac said. That got a frown from Cletus, but he didn't press the matter. That suited Mac. He didn't want to lie to the man. Not yet. Not unless it became necessary to escape the killers Pierre Leclerc had set on his trail. Chapter 3 Hiram Flowers spun the tip of his knife a few more times, bored the hole in the pine wood, and finished carving himself a spinner to make a new horsehair lariat. His old lariat had worn out during the last trail drive. At the memory of that drive the prior year, he looked up and saw his boss's widow come out onto the ranch house porch and begin sweeping. She had hired help for that, a maid. But Mercedes Sullivan preferred to keep her hand in running the house, the ranch, everything about the Circle Arrow. A tiny smile curled Flowers' chapped lips as the fiery redhead bent to flick away a bit of debris stuck between the porch boards. The sight of her made his heart race a little faster, and it wasn't just from how her perky rear end poked up into the air
or the gentle sway under her blouse. He knew those emerald eyes of hers were bright and clear, and hid none of her razor-sharp intelligence. She was a handsome woman, and a capable one when it came to business. She was also his boss. Flowers forced himself to pull his eyes away from her trim figure and mesmerizing ways. Her husband had been his best friend. No matter that Flowers had worked for Ezekiel Sullivan for more than 15 years. He had struck up an immediate friendship with the man because of who he was, not just because of his wife. Zeke had been his boss then. Mercedes was his boss now that the fever had taken Zeke 6 months back. He muttered that over and over. Boss, boss, boss. You say something, Mr. Flowers? He turned to Howard Messy Messerschmidt, a drover hired away from an adjoining ranch. Jake Church ran that spread in a slapdash way, hardly ever turned a profit, but somehow kept stumbling along, and he treated his hired hands worse than he did his steers. That made it easy to hire away the best of the drovers, men like Messerschmidt and his partner, Klaus Kleingeld, who didn't speak much English. That didn't bother Flowers overly. He had found some good men, hard workers and dedicated cowboys among the men from down in New Braunfels. He wished he could hire one of those German women as a cook. He never found a single one who couldn't whip up a meal fit for a king. I was reflecting on how lazy you and Kleingeld are. You have chores to do out in the barn. Every bit of the chores are done, Mr. Flowers. We rode through the cows corralled on the South 40, looking for any trace of splenic fever. Not a trace. Not even a tick bite on the lot. And those are the last of the herd to be examined. You look in on Cassidy? Flowers saw how the cowboy's face became a poker mask. That told him more than he wanted to know. He's still sleeping off his bender. Both of them looked at the clear blue Texas sky and the sun hanging high in it. They had been up by sunrise, doing all the chores necessary to keep the ranch running and to prepare for the drive. Cassidy hadn't stirred, other than to roll over in his bunk and snore even louder. Mr. Flowers! He looked up at the call and saw Cletus Grant waving at him. Cletus rode toward the house with another man on horseback beside him. He found a sucker, Messerschmidt said. Be happy about that. We need all the trail hands we can find after so many of them went south to work on the railroad. What's a cowboy know about laying iron track? Flowers stuck his knife in the bench beside him and stood. He ignored whatever Messy said in response. The man went on when he should have kept his yap shut. More important was the man riding alongside Grant. He sized him up fast. Wherever did Grant find such losers? The two men reined in, and Grant started to make the introductions. Mr. Flowers, this here's... Grant's words trailed off. It was apparent he hadn't bothered finding out the man's name, or if he had, he'd already forgotten it. Considering his age, either was possible. Dewey McKenzie, the young man said. Cletus here says you need cowboys, but my experience is more with cooking. You're a trail cook? Flowers spat. The day was turning sourer the higher the sun got in the sky. You don't look like one. I worked for Sidney Jefferson of the Rolling J, down around Waco. If you want to send him a telegram, he might not answer right away. He's mighty sickly and... Not wasting time or money on a telegram. You don't have the look of a man willing to sit astraddle a horse all night long. I've ridden night herd and don't take much to it. Like I told Cletus, my skills are elsewhere. Flowers took in the youngster. The revolver tucked into his belt had the look of being used hard and often, but he wasn't a gunfighter. Any gun slick worth his salt wore his iron on his hip. A gambler might use a shoulder rig, but having a pistol thrust into his belt like this spelled death if the hammer or cylinder caught on a vest or waistband during a quick draw. The only man he had ever heard of who carried a six-gun in a coat pocket and used it that way was a marshal out in El Paso, and he lined the pocket with leather to keep from getting the hammer tangled in cloth. Dewey McKenzie was no gunman, and he wasn't a cowboy.
"Can't use you. Sorry Cletus dragged you all this way for nothing."
"I can cook. I make the best damn biscuits any cowpoke ever ate. Keep the men happy and you'll get twice the work from them."
"He's right about that, Mr. Flowers."
Cletus shifted weight off his gimp leg and looked from one man to the other and back.
"I'll work an extra hour just for a decent meal. Remember the last drive when..."
"Shut up, Cletus."
Flowers tried to keep his shoulders from sagging. He faced Mac and said,
"We gotta cook. If you can't ride night herd as a wrangler, there's no place on a Circle Arrow drive for you."
He watched a curious ripple of emotion cross the young man's face. Mac took off his hat. The hole in the brim was fresh. There wasn't any fraying yet from wind or rain. His long, dark hair was plastered down from sweat, although the day wasn't that hot. Something riled him, and whatever it was wouldn't surface. He had the look of a man with harsh secrets to keep. That meant a history Flowers had no desire to learn or have catch up with either the young man or anyone else on the drive. It was hard enough getting across West Texas and up into New Mexico territory along the Goodnight-Loving Trail without keeping a close eye on your back trail.
"I can ride herd. I'm not too good, and I'd rather go as cook. I am good at that."
"Sorry."
Flowers glared at Cletus Grant. The man had expected a finder's fee for another rider.
"But, sir, I..."
Mac's words were drowned out by three quick gunshots, followed by a loud whoop like an Indian on the warpath coming after a scalp. Flowers saw he was wrong about the boy not being handy with his revolver. He had it out and cocked in the blink of an eye, the muzzle pointed up at the bunkhouse roof. Slower to turn, Flowers only touched the butt of his six-gun and didn't throw down when he saw Cassidy teetering on the edge of the roof, buck naked, with a gun in one hand and a bottle in the other.
"I'm a ring-tailed, rootin', tootin' son of a bitch from Pecos, and I can take any man on this godforsaken ranch."
Cassidy raised his six-gun again. The motion unbalanced him and caused his feet to slip from under him. He sat hard, then slid down the shingled roof. He landed awkwardly, sprawled in the dirt, and didn't move. He hadn't killed himself, though. His breath still wheezed and bubbled in his throat. Cletus cringed at the inelegant sight of Cassidy's bare butt and muttered,
"I ain't pulling the splinters from his cracker ass."
"Messerschmitt, get the drunken fool back into the bunkhouse and sober him up,"
Flowers ordered.
"I don't care if you have to pour 10 gallons of coffee down his throat. I want him sober before sundown."
"Can't see how that's possible, Mr. Flowers. He's never sober, I declare. He's got whiskey instead of blood flowing through his veins."
Flowers glared. Messerschmitt kicked the pistol from Cassidy's unsteady hand, caught his wrist, and pulled the man to his feet. As the drunk toppled forward, he got a shoulder into Cassidy's belly and hoisted him like a sack of grain. A quick kick of his heel opened the door. He made no effort to keep from banging Cassidy's head against the frame as he carried him into the bunkhouse. In his drunken condition, the man never noticed.
"That's our cook," Cletus said. "Mr. Flowers, you can't depend on Cassidy."
"No, wait, I'm wrong. That's exactly how you'll see him along the trail, since he'll have the liquor supply under lock and key."
"Hush up. And you," Flowers said, spinning on Mac. "Clear out."
He closed his eyes when a soft voice from the direction of the ranch house summoned him. Resolute, he left his problems with the men and went to see what Mercedes Sullivan had to say. Every step closer to the porch, where she stood with arms crossed over her breasts, foot tapping, and an expression just this side of a hellfire and brimstone sermon, convinced him climbing a gallows to be hanged was easier. Disappointing Mercedes was worse for him than a noose around his neck.
"Yes, ma'am," Flowers said, stopping at the foot of the steps leading to the porch. From here, he looked up at her.
"That's enough ruckus from Cassidy. He's drunk again, isn't he? I won't stand for that. No man who works for the Circle Arrow can be as soused as he is right now."
"I need him, Miss Sullivan. He's our cook."
"I heard about the trouble you had with him on the last drive. Zeke said he got into the cooking stores constantly and was seldom sober. If you hadn't stopped him, my husband would have sent Cassidy packing."
"It's not good to be on the trail and firemen, especially the cook. I can ride scout, and Messerschmitt is as good with the herd as any man I've seen."
"Yes, yes," she said impatiently. "And Cletus Grant can soothe any horse in the Ramuda." She relaxed a little, her arms dropping. She sat down on the top step and pointed to a spot beside her. She pointed more emphatically when he hesitated to sit beside her. Flowers sighed and lowered himself stiffly to the plank step, being careful not to sit inappropriately close to her.
"It's a long drive," he said. "If we go all the way to Denver with this herd, I'll need seasoned men, and plenty of them."
"Hiram, you have to fire Cassidy."
I
know he's your nephew, and it would break your sister's heart for her youngest to get fired. Do you want me to do your job for you? I will no longer permit a man to be that drunk and remain in my employ." Flowers began,
"Your work with the Temperance League is..."
"That has nothing to do with firing Cassidy. He's a poor worker, plain and simple. And I have heard the men grumbling about his cooking. Whether he does a poor job because he's a drunk or not drunk enough doesn't matter."
"Yes, ma'am." Flowers sighed heavily again. "I'll send him back to his ma."
"Hiram, trust me. She knows what a wastrel he is. Now, when do we hit the trail?"
"I'll be ready at dawn in 2 days."
"Good. That'll give me time to get my gear together. Have one of the men see that Majestic is ready then."
"Majestic? But that's your horse. I don't need to take your horse. We got 50 head for the Ramuda, and what did you ride here?"
She looked at him, red-headed, beautiful, and absolutely determined as she said, "You misunderstand me, Hiram. I want my horse ready, because I'm riding along with you on this drive." Flowers opened his mouth, then snapped it shut. No words came out. He stared at her, and all he could see were the high cheekbones, fair skin, and that flowing long red hair. She might have been an Irish elf, she was so pretty. "Zeke always went with the herd. Since he's gone, it's my duty as owner."
"You can't,"
he blurted out the denial. The shock on her face that he would speak to her that way turned to stubbornness he knew couldn't be changed. She was downright mulish when she set her mind to something.
"Ms. Sullivan, it's dangerous on the trail. Hard going every inch of the way. It's not like running the ranch and having a nice soft bed at night."
"You think so little of me, Hiram? I'm tough enough. I need to go along to get the best deal I can. You're not much of a haggler."
"Never had to be. Not with Mr. Sullivan along. I swear, I never saw a man better able to squeeze an extra dime out of a cattle buyer."
He realized as soon as he said it that he had played right into her hands. "Since you lack the experience, It'll be good for you to see me use my feminine wiles to accomplish the same ends that Zeke achieved." She sounded smug, satisfied, as if she had practiced that line to recite for him. He refused to be convinced.
"Ma'am, all you have to do is bat those long eyelashes of yours and hearts melt."
"Like yours?" Her expression became unreadable. The words were light and joshing, but Flowers heard something else there he dared not believe.
"I won't be a party to you going. I'll quit. I'll take half the men with me, too."
"You'd leave me your nephew and no one else?" Anger rose now, turning her milky cheeks rosy. Her lips thinned to a line, and her green eyes flashed like warning beacons. Flowers had to tread carefully, or she might fire him and try to lead the drive by herself.
"I'll get rid of Cassidy, I promise you that. But I'll need a cook."
"And for me to stay at home, tallying accounts and minding the home fires?"
"Yes, ma'am. Exactly."
Flowers almost sagged in relief. He had convinced her to stay. The trail was no place for a lady like her. Then she drove another knife into his gut and twisted it around. "I will remain behind on one condition. Desmond rides with you."
"Your son?"
Flowers swallowed hard. It was almost better if he took Cassidy. He could deal with a drunk. His father's death hit him hard. It's time for him to snap out of the funk he's been in since the funeral and learn how to run a ranch. Watching you with the herd on the trail will stand him in good stead.
"Desmond?"
The name came out in a croak.
"He's not even here. He went back to town."
I wondered where he'd gotten off to. Fetch him. Get him outfitted and teach him what he needs to know. Otherwise, I...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.